a quiet day. My poem, I place the weight of the day on your shoulders. A quiet day. No gong of terror sounding. Not the grand style of the Hector striding forth. But the quiet braveries take you. Say the man unlocking his store at 8 despite the gunman. Say the feverish child, the mother all night beside him. All the little acts, the endurance of the aged. My neighbor McPhee, sweat dripping from his chin, 84, and he feels it, painting his empty home. Or a wife assisting a long divorce of her husband from his large dreams. Or a widow baking bread. Or Andromeda laughing the heavy horse crest helmet set on the brow of her son. The day before, the day after. To a special edition of the creative community devoted to the memory of Barry Spacks. Barry was Santa Barbara's first poet laureate, serving from 2005 to 2007. But I knew him since 2001 as a member of a group of poets who meet once a month, every third Sunday. After Barry's passing on January the 28th, I knew I wanted to remember him on this show, on which he appeared as a guest 4 times. But I faced a problem. How in the world could I interview all the poets in Santa Barbara whose lives Barry had touched? There are far too many to fit in a 1-hour program. And so the people remembering Barry today here at Santa Barbara City College's Lifescape Garden are all members of the Sunday Poets Group. Think of their words and memories as a sampling of what is being felt and thought by poets, not just in Santa Barbara, but across the country and around the world.
The first time I met Barry, well, actually, my first connection with Barry was through absence, because I was attending a teacher summer course in UCSB, and I remember the professor telling us the very best day is coming up, the very best day, it's Barry Spacks Day, it's when we have Barry Spacks in. And it just so happened that very best Barry Spacks Day was the one day I had to miss in the entire summer institute. And so I was sorry about that, I missed Barry Spacks, and then I think it was next year or the year after I did the Literature Institute, and they said, we've got a wonderful guest coming, Barry Spacks. And that also happened to be the day I missed. So I had this sense of missing twice the very best day, which was Barry Spacks Day. And then eventually I got into this group, and a writing group, and I had the very best day once a month for 10 years.
I met Barry, I actually have the date here in a poetry book I bought from him at the first meeting of Barry at a reading he did in downtown Santa Barbara at Giuseppe's, of all places, which is no longer there. But it was an exceptional reading, and I went up to him after and I bought the book and he inscripted it for me. So that was it, 7/20/1994. So I've known Barry for over 20 years now.
I don't quite remember when I first met Barry, but I do know that it was at a poetry reading, and I was so impressed with his poetry, of course, his dignity, his graciousness, his sense of humor. I thought, this is a person I'd really like to meet. And not too long after that, a book of poetry of mine was coming out. I was just beginning to put my toes in the Santa Barbara poetry waters, and I was a little afraid to approach him to write a blurb for my book, but I did, and he said, oh, of course, I'm so honored. And he did. That was Barry.
I have heard of Barry for a long time, but I first met him when he sent poems to my magazine. At that time it was called Cafe Solo. I published it for 50 years. He sent a poem. I liked the poem so much that eventually, as Cafe Solo evolved, I asked him for a cover. And this one is called Solo. Isn't that a wonderful drawing? He had art shows, and this is from one of his art shows. And there's even a little figure on the back. So charming. And he always supported the magazine, used it in one of his classes. And to me, that was Barry. He was a person for all occasions. And whenever I needed something, I asked Barry, whether it was a blurb, a review, he was always there. But he had such a gentle presence. I don't think at the time I realized what a giant he was. And that's one thing I feel bad about. I miss him every day of my life. And this is such a beautiful day for remembering him with the beautiful sea and the sailboats. I'm glad to think of that eternity for him. Such a beautiful day.
You know, the first time that I met Barry is, I don't remember the first time I met Barry. I think the thing about Barry is that when I started coming up to poetry in Santa Barbara sometime in the early 90s, Barry was just there. Barry was everywhere. And as I was a host, Barry kept showing up to readings, and I got to know him, and it was really a wonderful get to know.
We moved here about 26 years ago, and I think it was shortly after we moved that I became more interested in writing poetry and joined in some of the readings, so it must have been at one of those. I do have a distinct memory of Barry introducing Robert Pinsky, perhaps when he was Poet Laureate, I'm guessing that was 15 years ago, and inviting me over to his home on Bath Street afterwards for a little reception. That's when I first met you. Would that have been 15 years ago?
Almost, yeah.
Yeah? Okay. Yeah.
I first met Barry in a poetry workshop that he organized or helped to organize about 17 years ago, and there were only four of us. And that group stayed together for many years and became really critical in forming who I am as a poet and the way I thought about poetry and poetry as a community. He had a way of shaping communities and people would stick together. It's wonderful.
Well, I met him first reading a letter of recommendation for a graduate student to come to UCSB. And I read this very good, solid letter, and it was signed Barry Spacks. About 2 weeks later, I'm reading Poetry Magazine, May 1966. And this eight-page poem by somebody whose last name is Dull. D-U-L-L, and I think, doesn't he have the sense to get a pen name? Turn the page and here, two sparkling things by Barry Spacks, the same name that I'd seen on the letter of recommendation. And the second one is called Recommendations. And it's really close. And I think I should read that. This is a good fellow. Who knows what he may do? He is most excited. He is climbing the walls of himself on tiptoe. Give him a prize. And this one is steady. It is clear that he is breathing. He will never kill any number of old ladies, nor harrow hell. Give him a prize.
I often say that, and I really believe it, that the poems are so much smarter than I am, that they're always teaching me something, and I think that's rather common with poets. There's also this sense of, you can only use the word gift, this sense that something's coming through, you're not quite the writer of the poem, you're something like the conductor of a bunch of musicians, but they're there first, and they're the ones who are doing the work.
Right.
It's a great mystery.
Barry was the consummate, thoughtful guy. and I use that word in the broadest sense. He was thoughtful about the world, he was thoughtful about his friends, his family, and his writing reflects that again and again. He was a true Buddhist in the sense that he brought into his life everything he experienced as far as I could see. He had the ability to take off the narcissistic ego coat that most of us wear at will and look at life as though it were a Rubik's Cube, which it comes out in his poetry, and that's what I love about his poetry the most. I'm gonna read a couple poems from the first meeting with Barry where I got this book he wrote called Imagining the Unicorn. And the first one I think kind of represents his leadership and protectiveness about all of us. This is called Wolf of the World. All the tale is bare your breast, bare your heart. The fever's brief, simply every day the rest. Wolf of the world and the fear of grief. Wolf of the world, he's at our door. His rank snout worries every crack. We've long since finished hoping for some sop or stroke to turn him back. No fantasy survives his greed, but proud of what he drives me to, I lift myself, your broken reed, and I club the wolf of the world for you. And the next one is Spack Street. I think it's a well-known poem by him. Fame, whole generations going up in peak, uncalled, unchosen, silly to waste much strength. Earning a place of note, there's not a grave without its certified has been. But once I wanted a star in my name, or a state, a river, a unit of measure. A street at least, Spacks Street, Spacks Place. How nice, I imagine, the little kids playing giant steps after dinner in summer, leaping from one of your curbs to another. Or someone moves, does well, gains weight and years and accolades and says, God, if they only could see me today, the old gang back on Spacks Street.
What I really love about Barry's work is the humor. The humor in poetry is just, it's such a hard thing to work, and he does it so well. As a person who gets stuck writing, this is an interesting way to look at that, and it's called Worrying the Muse. You used to come nightly, kick off your heels, hum in my ear. How my atoms purred from the way you laughed when you were cheating at Scrabble. I know our deal, no questions asked, no fits if you lurch in from partying with the whole translation committees. Sure, no one's about to love you tame, but look, how abject can I get? The study's dusted, quiet. I've set cornflowers on the desk, our favorite, pad and pencil, whatever helps. Did you just get too damn lonesome for Tangiers or Massachusetts snow? No, tell, is there someone else? That is such an incredible Barry poem. You know, it's funny and it addresses a problem that we all have, whether it's writers or just figuring out what to do for the day.
For someone who'd never read Barry's poetry, I would say be prepared to read each poem about 25 times. His poetry had such depth to it that you could never get it on the first reading. You know, I always thought Barry was immortal, and when he passed, I thought, how could this be? You know, there's no way that Barry is gone. And I immersed myself in his poems. And every poem I read, I found new beginnings over and over and over again. And I was able to tell myself, you know what? He is immortal. What Breathes Us by Barry Spacks. Regards to the day, the great long day, that can't be hoarded, good or ill. What breathes us likely means us well. We rise up from an earthly root to seek the blossom of the heart. What breathes us likely means us well. We are a voice impelled to tell where the joining of sound and silence is. We are the tides and their witnesses. What breathes us likely means us well.
This poem I have has a lot to do with Barry's work. Would it be appropriate? It's called Crossing Guard, and it has an epigraph from Barry. Don't mess with him, Annie. He's your crossing guard, Barry Spacks. This morning, I'm writing in the sculpture garden in this desert museum. The fountain thrusts up water boisterously, no quiet seep over rocks. The founders must have chosen to provide this presence, this assurance of water in the desert. Drops royal, mixed with air, scatter light of all wavelengths into white, and then fall back and subsume into one body. Water and shadows from a high stone wall, as if the garden knows what I'm afraid of out here. The last poem of Barry's we published in Askew draws a portrait of a macho crossing guard. The crossing guard is based on a photograph, so this particular guard is no metaphor. He really does wear Robocop sunglasses and a scowl. A sense of repose beside this fountain, time without end, a gentle wind, no more than a ruffling. No one else around. I could watch light shift and shift myself with the shadows forever. You could say Barry's poem is one more meditation in a long series on the struggle of the ego to attain authority, on the struggle of the soul to renounce power. One more in a wisdom series on the consequences of putting on power. Though the poem is an elbow in the ribs of masculine aspiration, it's gentle with the crossing guard himself, a man who has balanced his inner warrior with the impulse to protect, the yin with the yang. He must be careful not to be too gruff with those sunglasses and that huge cowboy hat. Hot light falls across my shoulder, my writing hand, and I have to move. If any poem is an attempt to answer the question, to what can we liken life on this earth? This one likens it to a comic crossing guard striving after masculine authority, but succeeding in shepherding children across a busy street. When Barry sent us the poem, I wrote back and told him I too had problems with the crossing guard who called me Tiny Tears after a doll of that time who cried real tears. In kindergarten, I already had social issues, younger than the others, smaller, less mature, and unfortunately, I distinguished myself by escape attempts, flying out the double doors and down the stairs with the teacher and every one of my classmates behind me. I was too small to reach the latch of the gate. The other kids kept an eye on me, a look of amused readiness, a hopeful sneer. Let it rip, little girl. When the crossing guard started calling me Tiny Tears on top of everything else, it was more than I could bear. Barry wrote back, "How odd that he'd call you anything other than precious," and closed with a double salutation, shortly. Drop down three lines, fondly. At the time, I thought shortly meant that I'd see him very soon. But now I know shortly means we have little time. Fondly means kindness is all. And none of us should be anything other than precious in each other's sight. Thank you, Barry, for giving us words that stretch in two directions like a suspension bridge, reaching always towards equilibrium, toward laughter and memory, toward implacable fate. The fountain churns on with its small roar, and the turbulence of water mixes with air, breaks light into all the shades human eyes can see, mingling in one bright color.
I like how anything can be said in a poem. Some feel otherwise, but what do they know? Like one day here on Bath Street, always happy until a gobbet of tooth sheared off at the front of my mouth as I crunched a chicken bone. Whoa! I think it's great the way a poem can stop, start, shift to the right like a broken field runner, plus broken reminds me I'd better tongue that tooth. Did you think, Charlene, when you started this poem, it would turn out so badly? But there you go, rushing in the way you do.
I think the amazing thing was an attention to detail plus an overview of where this was all leading, what it was all about. At this stage, he was writing more formal. The first one was very formal, meter and rhyme. But you can see them loosening up as it goes through. The recommendations, for instance, what the two stanzas match each other, but they're not a fixed form. Another poem in here that shows how he wrote then, blind in his sorrow and his fitful joy, he travels through the tangled wood of self while she moves on beside him, meadow sweet. He blunders in the dark, afraid to see how always she beside him and before makes everywhere a clearing, everywhere. He stands upon his shadow's shrunken noon, and if he'd take one step, he'd come into her love that waits for him. A summer field. I think that's beautiful. I think that's a good indication of his, let's call it his early style. It was a sense that he was right on top of every poem, really into it, working this meticulous attention, and finding different, there's something wrong here. And so, okay, how about using this word or that word? He might not be right about which word to use, but he was right that there was something wrong at that point. And then he'd have these larger ideas of, let's move this section up around and make this the beginning and this is the end and leave out this other part and, you know, radically altering your original conception of the poem. And this is actually, over the years, this is what I valued most.
There's really a lyrical touch, and he can be very funny, a great narrator of stories from his past. It's no surprise that he was also a novelist in that ability to tell stories. And I wonder, perhaps more of the Buddhist influence, which was, I think, strong for him later in life. These very sort of gnomic, koan sort of poems, these these riddles, these metaphysical riddles that would sort of float off, and he'd sort of list one after the other. So I can't think of too many poets with as much range as he had in his verse.
We really have to feel our way over many drafts, mm-hmm. and sometimes many years, in order to answer just that question. Often we have a lot more material in the poem toward the beginning, when we just get a surge of interest, right. and the language seems to feed off of itself, and then we need to tighten it, and we're paying attention to the musicality of the line and so on, looking for something a little bit more strong than perhaps elsewhere in the mm-hmm. poem to end with.
Mm-hmm. Here's a poem by Barry from his life as a teacher. He taught for many years humanities at MIT in Boston. And this poem by Barry is from his book, Spacks Street, and it's called Themes on Love. Grading themes on love at MIT, one man symposium at 3 a.m. Across the court, I saw a light. Another office holder working late. While Plato on a silver pillow rode above the waves of pre-sophistic prose, I jotted teachers' notions that were not as brave as our two lamps against the glut of dawn. But when I clicked mine off, his too at once was gone. Had been my echo in a distant sheen of glass, had been my own, and I was lonely then and wrote these English words.
I think one of the things that really defines Barry's poetry is economy. He's very economical with his words, and he was never one for flowery language or, you know, heavy sentiment. It was all, you know, a lot of image, a lot of passion, a lot of desire. He wrote a lot about that connection between men and women and that constant tension and drama. You know, it was very important to him. This is a poem by Barry that I've always felt like at this point I could kind of substitute Barry for Pablo Neruda. This is his poem, Seeing Pablo Neruda. One fall day, I saw Pablo Neruda, small as life, crossing Plimpton Street, unnoted, wearing a hard expression. His thoughts on the bombing, I thought, endless bombing. And even I might possibly not have known it was Pablo Neruda, except for an instant before I'd seen, in the Grolier bookstore, his photo, pausing to maybe buy the Bellet and Reed translations. A Latin lady held his arm, or rather his elbow, the way you do with a maestro. Be careful, maestro, the traffic. I think it was Pablo Neruda, passing part of his residence on Earth, perhaps in town to visit his fellow diplomat poet Octavio Paz. Could be, who knows. Such things aren't sure, but what struck me was I wanted to follow. I wanted to shout, hey, somebody, look, look, that's Pablo Neruda, the Chilean poet, ambassador to France. I was talking to Mary Kay, who sells her pottery masks on a sliding scale as a spit in the eye to the price-tagging world. So you give what you can if you want one of Mary's works, say the bas-relief of a sun god. The product, that's what it's all about. I see a girl gussied up in a sheep fleece coat, and that's the product. I hear a praiser in the hall, a student listens, a stock goes up, and that's the product. Pablo Neruda, Nobel Prize, made a speech in New York, said the South American future was finally on. There he goes, past Levitt and Pierce's, the Holyoke Center, and no one but me to recognize. And what if it wasn't Pablo Neruda? What if it was Octavio Paz? The product, it's there on the big board. It's death to diffuse. It's you in your soi distant Chilean sheep rancher's raunchy coat, valued person, your super low sexy voice, your glances around sheep's collars. Now who wouldn't buy? Pray if you ever see Pablo Neruda, who praised his socks, who damned the whores and the prophets, the sickly horror of profit and loss. Pray to be not for sale, to walk the earth in the pride of life, to give as much as you can. Barry Spacks.
I'm going to miss Barry. I'm going to miss his humor, his, you know, his insight into whatever we're doing, whatever I'm doing, and whatever's going on in poetry. I think that I've been in the workshop with him for a long, long time, and I really, it's going to be hard to see that workshop without Barry. And it's going to be hard to see him not in the community. And I wanted to say one other thing. You know, when Ventura started a poet laureateship, and when we were setting up the idea of a poet laureate committee, what we were looking at is what Barry did with his poet laureateship, how he involved the community, how he spread poetry throughout Santa Barbara, and how he did it in the incredible positive way that he did, the inclusion, you know, all of these things that Barry did. And so when we were putting together our idea of a poet laureate, that's what we were looking at. We were looking at Barry as inspiration, as an example. When Barry was poet laureate, he decided to be in a slam at UCSB, which I just loved the thought of Barry in a slam. And I didn't see it, so I wrote a poem about Barry in the slam. Barry at the slam. At the slam, Barry tells me, I should smile more. This is supposed to be fun, he says. And you might want to work on your phrasing. Your rhythm seems off. Barry hits the stage with his lifelong affection of words beaming through his performance. He is charming this audience as he has charmed us all. The words booming out of his mouth with informed discernment and a touch of glee. Pure Barry. He doesn't win the slam, although I would love to see him with the heavyweights at the Taos Poetry Circus. Barry's insightful voice and advice has given me much to ponder, to smile at. And I suppose he's right about the phrasing.
That's, I like the sense that we go back and back and back to a poem over and over again. Our favorite poems we've probably read hundreds of times, and yet they always seem to bring something new. Mm-hmm. How does that miracle work, Barry?
They seem like ticking little machines of some sort, and when they're well done and very cunning, so that every part is beautifully golden and polished and works in the gearings of the whole ensemble. They seem to leap us into some kind of feeling thought, some kind of heart thought. Very seldom is it just some idea. It's almost always an idea that's tied to emotion.
Some gut feeling.
Feeling that's working there. And people have been trying for centuries, I guess, to try to explain why this particular art works that way. We know that, say, in music, it goes right to the feelings. There may be ideas involved, there may be actually words involved, but unless that surge of involvement with the feeling is there, it's not music. Well, we have some musical qualities in the way we use language as poets as well, so that's one of the auxiliary energies that comes into a poem. I think it has something to do with the fact that we we're working in a medium that we all share. There's not a human who doesn't share language, mm-hmm. as opposed to painting or, you know, sawing away at a cello or something like that. So that's our medium, and it's a kind of everyday thing. And the poem exists somewhere between, I think ideally, somewhere between mm-hmm. that everyday use of language so that it's comprehensible on right. some level. And then it always flirts with the unexpected. So the unexpected kind of attacks you. It sort of stops you and makes you think about whatever it is the poem is mm-hmm. focused on. So that's, I guess, what we mean by the need for originality
yeah.
in poetry, yeah.
Well, I will miss Barry's encouraging presence. I will miss that kind of patriarchal presence of poetry, I mean, in the best sense of that word. Someone who had a lot of experience, knew a lot of poets, had written poetry for a lifetime, was still generous to those of us younger than he. I'll miss those times in our workshop where one of us would read a poem and he said, "I think that's just perfect." You know, he would occasionally say that. I probably won't miss those times where he'll hone in on a part of one of our poems and beat it to death because he's thought the poem has gone off the tracks. And he won't be shy about letting you know. Although, of course, it's important to listen in those moments. So he wasn't just a dispenser of praise. He could be pretty keen in his criticism, and I think both parts I'll miss. I think the way Barry read had a profound impact on me, and I think of it as a combination of gusto and tenderness, which is unique, and learned a lot about reading poetry. I will miss his voice. I will miss his voice. This is a little poem I wrote for Barry this week, thinking of my own indebtedness to him. It's called To Barry. I owe my poetry to Barry Spacks, the way a boxcar runs on railroad tracks. He was the locomotive, or perhaps the lingering caboose, the last synapse between a thought and motion of the pen. I don't know what to stipulate, and then I do. If Barry can, I'll say it too.
What I think I'll miss the most about Barry, as I sort of mentioned in the poem, is that there may be a time when I won't miss you, but I will always miss Barry, as we all will. And I will miss how he was so humble and so brilliant all at once. He treated all of us like we were his equals, and he always had something to say that would improve our poem no matter what. I think I have very few poems written in the last many years that hasn't been touched by Barry's hand and Barry's heart and Barry's impeccable ability to edit, and above all, his tremendous ability to love and treat us all as if we were one with him. As that poem says, you know, we are the tides and the witnesses.
One inch in time. I spent a long while in eclipse, when my heart pulsed little light. I hardly had strength to count missed blips, and oh, how I prayed, especially at night, while tucked in my blanket in my chair upright, that sleep would come and offer dreams of times before, of will and work and schemes. I had to give my future to the doctors. One for my blood, another for his electrical skill. They tested, shocked, and cauterized concoctors of this or that drug cocktail, what you will, but nothing tuned me up. I was grave ill. Nothing to be done, no magic pill. I named myself supine. Life perked along, excuse me, life perked along around me, but not mine. Eclipsed, darked out, just a thin corona glowed at the edge of this nullness that before was where I'd smile and talk, make love and art, and rode my vehicle of self as if it ran on air. I'm talking friends of something like despair. I couldn't even rise to greet a guest. Attended by a noble wife and daughter, I did my best. No, what I did supremely well was wait till breakfast lurched toward lunch. I managed to read at least the headlines in the paper, hate predominating. So thanks, world. Thanks a bunch for distracting wars and crimes and torture like a punch to an atrium already crazed. And now I'm back, paced by a machine that keeps the beat. And all I lack is the total ignorance I knew before, when I would take on 7 projects in a day, when my simple mantra through the years was more, more. The light returned, the black moon passed. Folks say I am myself again, yet in a way, I'm rather a patience than a self, pleased by each breath, forever now, 1 inch in time from death.
Here's a poem I wrote for Barry, thinking of how breath appeared always in his poems, in many, many of his poems, as a serious practitioner of Buddhism. Angel Man for Barry. When I was little, playing in an alley between our tall apartment and mortuary, we often watched the long black car drive in, smudge our hopscotch grid. It won't take long, the caretaker assured. We called him Angel Man. Never one to shun the dark, you aimed for light, embracing Buddha's 84,000 teachings. With mindful play, created an 84-character poem I've tried to emulate in your honor, every attempt scratched out. The time may come when I won't miss your wisdom and wit, chuckles over directional challenges, and the time you agreed to wear that goofy laurel wreath we created for you as our city's first poet laureate. In suit and ponytail, you read your masterful poem, pushing aside odd greenery from the clothes hanger halo, making light. We teased you as the bulldozer mowing weeds in our poems, so the angel might appear, you Michelangelo of words, though you preferred images of street or peach. Once you said, when the llama calls, you go. Devoted servant, you appear all light in dream, breathing joy. After sudden showers, you show up again, beginning again. That laurel wreath transformed to a halo of every color, arching our city end to end.
For me, has always kind of been the lion of the group. We're his pride, and we just look to him for that guidance and that wonderful looking out for us attitude he had. I got to listen to his work in progress, which was so exciting. I got to have him critique my work, which was equally exciting, and he was just so patient, so understanding, and protective of all of us. Barry, I will miss your humor, your ability to be light and delightful, and your ability to go into the deeper parts of human nature. You did it with such poise and grace. You were way too young to die. You were young at heart. You were so involved and passionate about life. It just doesn't quite seem right to me that you're gone, and I will miss you.
I have just wonderful memories of Barry, so many of them sitting around a table, you know, discussing words, and he just had this amazing laugh that, you know, usually at least, you know, half dozen times in any given meeting, he would just find something uproariously funny. And, it, you know, it just lift your spirits. It was amazing.
He just had the most infectious grin and joy of life. And in our own poetry group, he was always the one to zero in on what you could do to improve your poem. He was so erudite. But more than erudition, I think he was the one person in my life I knew who had wisdom itself. And that is the rarest quality, wisdom. And that's what I think. And to me, he is irreplaceable. As you know, for our workshop, we always have a theme. And when we knew Barry was ill and seeing a doctor, Perry suggested the theme, the doctor. And so I wrote one from my Willa Cather workshop. Barry helped me get together poems for a Willa Cather workshop I'm giving in Nebraska in May. And he helped me with a poem called Coyote and one called Drought. And this one, the last assignment was Doctor. And it tells about the doctor coming upon a graveyard in a crossroad where a man was buried. And it was from My Antonia, what the doctor said. Dr. Ed thought this was really a beautiful graveyard. Open and free, this little square of long grass, which the wind forever stirred. His friend was buried at a crossroads, so the spirit could not rise up. And this is how I want the afterlife for my friend, as natural as he was, as easy as the wind. That he was as easy as the wind, and everything was okay with him. No matter what I said or what I did, he accepted and blessed me for it. You have so few people in life who absolutely bless you for everything you do. And I miss him, and thank you, Barry.
Poet is reading a novel. One line, then another line. They are all linked. It's all in there. The German columns advancing like banks of clouds. They make a sense which escapes him. That brother who was left behind with an uncle in the third chapter turns up now, trying to recapture his heritage. The poet, intent on the vanishing charms of a heritage, its music, its verbal cadence, had forgot all about him. The novelist has read three novels this evening already. He picks up a volume of poems. He begins at the beginning. He is astonished by all that is left out. There are no moon, no shoulders, no conversations, ideas, yes, but he was taught what Mallarmé taught Degas. It is not with ideas that one makes sonnets, but with words. He has always wanted to depict that scene. M's apartment up one flight of tall stairs. The furniture, the windows, the paintings. My God, the impressionist paintings all over his walls. D's physique, mesomorphic, paint-flecked. And the outlines of figures Degas sets against his walls. The novelist is nothing if not an enthusiast. Around the poet, the ghost of his novelist hovers upside down like an image in a shiny doorknob. Wherever he goes, it goes with him, glossing his ample margins with invisible notes.
trying to think maybe the last time I saw him would be in November. Once was with our poetry group, and we were in Bruce's backyard. It's kind of odd being a November evening, but we were around the fire, and he seemed to be enjoying himself. We all enjoyed ourselves greatly, but I think I had a new book and a new reading maybe a week after that downtown, and he came and sat so appreciatively, as he always does, and came up, looked me in the eye, took me by the arm. Wanted to let me know how much he'd enjoyed the reading, and walked out. And you know, you never know when the last time is that you'll see someone, but I'll treasure that last time.
One of the things that was a big part of who Barry was his spirituality and his Buddhism. One hand holding. Barry is getting ready to go. That's all you Buddhists do. Say goodbye and goodbye from your cushions until your eyes stay cool and hooded no matter who they farewell. You practice leaving until it's like walking out to the patio, going to the kitchen for a little something, flipping a channel. Calm changing, no matter what unenlightened stomps and howls come from the ones left in this newly barren world. Stones, smooth and solid, below the currents of water. Barry, Barry, I would love you by being a stone, by being a branch on the bank, but you know, I am foolish and graspy. All I feel tonight is drowning and wanting your hand. One of the great things about Barry's poetry is, as good as the poetry was, Barry's voice was like amazing. And however good your poems were, they were never gonna sound as good as Barry's poems, because his poems were just like booming.